'Twas the night before Christmas, and the creature was stirring, not even a mouse.
In my mind,
welcome to another episode of God's Glory and History. I'm your host, MC Enemy. It's not about me, brothers and sisters. It's about the Word of God and His truth on this channel. Welcome to True Sabbath Fellowship. Yes, True Sabbath Fellowship is the new moon plus 7 days. Seventh day will be considered a Sabbath. So every 7 days after the new moon. So this episode is scheduled to be released on November the 18th, 2021. That will be the new moon. Welcome to Sabbath Fellowship, brothers and sisters. On this channel, it's the history that you need because Yahshua did bleed. All the rest will come when he comes on his steed. And of course, don't forget the prayer of Paul to the Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16 through 21. If you read it, it will bless you with understanding of God's word and his love for you. If you haven't done so yet, or you are new to this channel, we ask that you please download at least 2 Bible apps. Very important. Whole purpose of this channel is for you to read the Bible for yourself. Read your history for yourself. You're killing 2 birds with 1 stone, learning your history and getting closer with our Lord and Savior. And the reason why we say at least 2 Bible apps right in the middle of your screen, the facts of every case must be established by the testimony of 2 or 3 witnesses. In case you missed it, last week, episode 79, we showed in Scripture the location of the wilderness as mentioned in Revelations chapter 12, verse 14. Go back and look at that episode. It will bless you. Today, we are going to discuss the question, should we celebrate the upcoming holidays? And I got holidays in quotes for a reason. Now, the purpose of this episode is not to answer that question for you, but to give you the equipment or the tools for you to answer that question for yourself. Let's get to work. So the festive season or holidays are upon us again. But I want us to recognize that these family gathering days are just that, family gathering days. The Most High has not called these feasts. Therefore, they are not holy days. That's where the word holiday is derived from. So our holidays are not his holy days. New Living Translation, Isaiah chapter 1, verse 14. It is written, I hate your new moon celebrations and your annual festivals. They are a burden to me. I cannot stand them. That's some pretty strong language. But let's see what he's talking about. So these are not my words. This is a writer. I took it off of my source, and I don't get to have the source's name, but like I said, I don't want to take credit for it. These are someone else's words. So why then would he speak so strongly against Israel for the feast they observed? They were appearing before God as hypocrites. And we know God has, in his word, has much to say about hypocrites. The people were trying to appear obedient to God by outwardly keeping the biblical holy days or the altered days set by Jeroboam, while they secretly had other gods before him. God would have nothing to do with such hypocritical attempts at deception. Amos describes further transgressions in the way they kept the feast. Their attitude was wrong. God expressed his anger with Israel because they complained they could not sell grain and other things until after the Sabbath. New Living Translation, 1 Kings chapter 12, verse 26 through 33. It is written, Jeroboam thought to himself, unless I am careful, the kingdom will return to the dynasty of David. When these people go to Jerusalem to offer sacrifices at the temple of the Lord, they will again give their allegiance to King Rehoboam of Judah. They will kill me and make him their king instead. So on the advice of his counselors, the king made two gold calves. He said to the people, it is too much trouble for you to worship in Jerusalem. Look, Israel, these are the gods who brought you out of Egypt. He placed these calf idols in Bethel and in Dan at either end of his kingdom. But this became great sin, for the people worshiped the idols. Traveling as far north as Dan to worship the one there, Jeroboam also erected buildings at the pagan shrines and ordained priests from the common people, those who were not from the priestly tribe of Levi. And Jeroboam instituted a religious festival in Bethel, held on the 15th day of the eighth month, in imitation of the annual festival of shelters in Judah. There at Bethel, he himself offered sacrifices to the calves he had made, and he appointed priests for the pagan shrines he had made. So on the 15th day of the eighth month, a day that he himself had designated, Jeroboam offered sacrifices on the altar at Bethel. He instituted a religious festival for Israel, and he went up to the altar to burn incense. So now you understand, you know, what he meant by, you know, days, altered days. So it's not necessarily a sin to gather on certain days other than the days though the Most High has given. There's no problem with you gathering on another day that's not the day that the Most High has ordained. The sin is in replacing his holy days with your days and worshiping other idols. That would be the sin. So let me give you an example. If you, this is just me talking. If you wanted to gather with your family on Christmas, which we all pretty much know that that's not his true birthday, and it's not a ordained day that the Most High has called for, so as long as you're not replacing one of his ordained days with this day, and you're not worshiping idols, again, this is me talking, I don't see a problem with that. So we're going to need these tools to do a little bit further research. So I got the Hebrew months on the left of your screen, and then I have the new moon schedule for 2022 coming up. So this will help us when we have to pick out the months and the days, because the month starts on the new moon of that particular month. That's when the month officially starts, according to the Hebrew calendar. So there's only 7 feasts. You get the Feast of Passover, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Feast of First Fruits, the Feast of the Harvest, the Feast of Trumpets, the Feast of the Day of Atonement, and the Feast of Tabernacles. So we're going to look at each one of these, and you're going to see there's a little pattern I just noticed in doing this study. But let's look at each one. So Passover, 1611 King James Bible, Leviticus chapter 23, verse 5. It is written, in the 14th day of the first month, at even is the Lord's Passover. That's evening. That's short for evening. Is the Lord's Passover. So that's the new moon of September, or Tishri, plus 14 days is the Passover. So that's one festival we should be observing. The next, Unleavened Bread, 1611 King James Bible, Leviticus chapter 23, verse 6. It is written, and on the 15th day of the same month, is the Feast of Unleavened Bread unto the Lord. 7 days must ye eat unleavened bread. So that's, again, new moon of September, and plus 15 days, and you have to do it for 7 days. Next is the Feast of First Fruits. New Living Translation, Leviticus chapter 23, verses 10 through 14. It is written, give the following instructions to the people of Israel. When you enter the land I am giving you and you harvest its first crops, bring the priest a bundle of grain from the first cutting of your grain harvest. On the day after the Sabbath, the priest will lift it up before the Lord so it may be accepted on your behalf. On that same day, you must sacrifice a 1-year-old male lamb with no defects as a burnt offering to the Lord. With it, you must present a grain offering consisting of 4 quarts of choice flour moistened with olive oil. It will be a special gift, a pleasing aroma to the Lord. You must also offer 1 quart of wine as a liquid offering. Do not eat any bread or roasted grain or fresh kernels on that day until you bring this offering to your God. This is a permanent law for you, and it must be observed from generation to generation wherever you live. Now, we all know we don't do, you know, actual animal sacrifices anymore, but there's not anything really stopping us from doing the other things. I mean, many of us don't cut down wheat because we're not farmers. But you basically, you bring a gift or an offering to the Lord. And in nowadays, that's basically giving to your local institution of worship. So when is first fruits normally observed? Well, that, I mean, that could depend on your location and your crop, because if you're in the northern hemisphere, you know, autumn is one time, and if you're in the southern hemisphere, it's exactly opposite, 6 months out. So in the northern hemisphere here in the United States, this year, as an example, it was celebrated on April 4th of 2021. Now, the harvest feast, which comes next, will be 50 days from the first fruits. So the harvest feast is dependent on the first fruits feast. So the harvest feast, New Living Translation, Leviticus chapter 23, verses 15 and 16, and also 21, it is written, "From the day after the Sabbath, the day you bring the bundle of grain to be lifted up as a special offering, count off 7 full weeks. Keep counting until the day after the 7th Sabbath, 50 days later. Then present an offering of new grain to the Lord. That same day will be proclaimed as an official day for holy assembly, a day on which you do no ordinary work. This is a permanent law for you, and it must be observed from generation to generation wherever you live." So first fruits, which we said was April 4th, plus 50 days, makes May 24th of 2021 would have been the Feast of Harvest. Next is the Feast of Trumpets. New Living Translation, Leviticus chapter 23, verses 24 and 25, it is written, "Give the following instructions to the people of Israel. On the first day of the appointed month in early autumn, you are to observe a day of complete rest. It will be an official day for holy assembly, a day commemorated with loud blasts of a trumpet. You must do no ordinary work on that day. Instead, you are to present special gifts to the Lord." So this year, that was September 6th of 2021, the new moon. Next is the Feast of Atonement. New Living Translation, Leviticus chapter 23, verses 27 through 28 and 31 through 32, it is written, "Be careful to celebrate the Day of Atonement on the 10th day of that same month, 9 days after the Festival of Trumpets. You must observe it as an official day for holy assembly, a day to deny yourselves and present special gifts to the Lord." So that's new moon of September plus 10 days. Continuing on, "Do no work during that entire day, because it is a day of atonement when the offering of purifications are made for you, making you right with the Lord your God. You must not do any work at all. This is a permanent law for you, and it must be observed from generation to generation. Wherever you live, this will be a Sabbath day of complete rest for you, and on that day you must deny yourselves," which is fasting. "This day of rest will begin at sundown on the 9th day of the month and extend until sundown on the 10th day of the month." So this is after the new moon, right? So ninth, the evening of the 9th day after the new moon, and it ends on the evening of the 10th day after the new moon in September. And then we have the Feast of Tabernacles, also known as the Feast of Shelters. New Living Translation, Leviticus chapter 23, verses 34 through 36, verse 39, and verse 41 through 43. It is written, Give the following instructions to the people of Israel. Begin celebrating the festival of shelters on the 15th day of the appointed month, 5 days after the Day of Atonement. This festival to the Lord will last for 7 days. On the first day of the festival, you must proclaim an official day for holy assembly when you do no ordinary work. For 7 days, you must present special gifts to the Lord. The 8th day is another holy day on which you present your special gifts to the Lord. This will be a solemn occasion, and no ordinary work may be done that day. Remember that this 7-day festival to the Lord, the Festival of Shelters, begins on the 15th day of the appointed month after you have harvested all the produce of the land. The first day and the 8th day of the festival will be days of complete rest. You must observe this festival to the Lord for 7 days every year. This is a permanent law for you, and it must be observed in the appointed month from generation to generation. For 7 days, you must live outside in little shelters. All native-born Israelites must live in shelters. This will remind each new generation of Israelites that I made their ancestors live in shelters when I rescued them from the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God. So there's a lot of things going on in September that we don't know about. That month is a pretty special month. Lots of worship going on in September. Now, I know many of us dodged a bullet with that camping stuff because it said natural-born Israelites, or excuse me, not natural, native-born Israelites. So, I mean, I'm not sure if that would extend to us. I mean, we were not born in Israel. So, and it says native-born. But you have to make up your own mind with that. So this year, it was September 20th through September 27th, if I'm counted my days correctly, was the Feast of Shelters. So there's, like I said, there's many different celebrations and feasts going on in September. So something's turning around in my head, making me think about that, and I have to do a little bit more studying on it. So instructions for all the feasts, New Living Translation, Leviticus chapter 23, verse 37 and 38. It is written, "These are the Lord's appointed festivals. Celebrate them each year as official days for holy assembly by presenting special gifts to the Lord, burnt offerings, grain offerings, sacrifices, and liquid offerings, each on its proper day. These festivals must be observed in addition to the Lord's regular Sabbath days, and the offerings are in addition to your personal gifts, the offerings you give to fulfill your vows, which is tithes, and the voluntary offerings you present to the Lord." All right, brothers and sisters, so if you want to become part of the Lord's family and learn more from your history book and get closer to the Lord, we offer you the suggested prayer. You can pause it, recite it, and if you've done so with sincerity and thanksgiving in your heart, I want to be the first to welcome you to the family. But on this channel, we don't make orphans, so I'm not going to, you know, leave you hanging. Here's the things for you to do to grow in your faith. Number one is to read your Bible daily. And I know many say they don't know how to do it. It's too difficult. I got you covered. Go look at episode 62 on this channel. It's titled You're His Story. I think I might change that title just to make it easier to find, like how to read the Bible type of thing. But right now it's labeled You're His Story. It will guide you on how to read the Bible. Step number two, Find a Bible-based place for you to grow. This place must feed your spirit and your mind. The Bible tells you to worship. God is looking for people to worship him in spirit and in truth. So it must do those two things. And the third thing is for you to pray without ceasing. Seek the Most High's advice for everything that you do. All right, brothers and sisters, don't forget to set your phones for 12:34 a.m. and p.m. Eastern Standard Time. It's about us speaking with one voice, 60 seconds of meditation, just simply saying kumbaya, kumbaya. Come by God. And of course, you can catch me on Facebook, Hebrew Connect TV, YouTube, and now we've added Rumble. You can follow us on Facebook and the other channels. You can simply subscribe. We'd love to have you. If this episode has blessed you, edified you in some way, give it the thumbs up. More importantly, share it with others. Email address right in the middle of your screen, and you can also drop me a line in the comments. Love to hear from you guys. So love you guys. Appreciate you guys for watching. As always, worship the Father, praise the Son, and accept the Holy Spirit. May our Lord and Savior grant you his peace that surpasses all understanding. May it rest, rule, and abide with you, now, henceforth, and forevermore. Amen.
Christ the Savior.